Shopping Service. My name is Zoe Grant and I'm a senior psychosocial practitioner with First Contact Clinical. So I bet you Shopping Service, so we're going to look at what did we do, so in terms of the service. In summary, we improved self-management through psychosocial interventions by integrating the primary healthcare pathways. Our target population began with adults diagnosed with COPD or diabetes. People entered our surveys by us integrating a part of their annual review for COPD or diabetes. The intervention received was based on their PAM patient activation measure score. Those with the lowest PAM scores were offered the most intensive of the interventions. Therefore, we were able to offer a proportionate response to depending on the patient activation measure. So we drew on our experience from our work that we'd done previously with people with addictions. So it was a combination of psychosocial interventions delivered by a multidisciplinary team, trained practitioners and people with a lived experience as well, with evidence-based clinical care, which was delivered by medical and other clinical staff, is considered normal best practice in this particular long-term condition. And we were struck that that wasn't the case for other long-term health conditions where the care was predominantly from a medical or clinical staffing background and where the focus was predominantly the physical consequences of that long-term condition. So it was also informed by our success delivering the Ways to Wellness in the west of Newcastle. As one of four providers, we were seen as the most successful for integrating with GP practices in that area. Of the referrals, as you can see, 47% of those referrals were generated by First Contact Clinical. Due to our success, we have had practices who have transferred to us, who were referrers. For example, one practice made 18 referrals in 31 months preceding the transfer, and then following a circuit engagement programme, they've now referred 151 people in the past 14 months. The Ways to Wellness team use a wellbeing star to measure improvement, where obviously in South Tyneside we use the PAM. On an average, people have improved more than double the target that was given at the beginning. Analysis of secondary care costs for the Ways to Wellness team is measured by comparing a full cohort of patients with a similarly matched cohort from the other half of Newcastle that are not engaging in the service, and it showed that the costs were 36% lower per head than in the comparison cohort in an 18-month period. In 2017 to 2018, secondary care activity per 100,000 patients increased as twice the rate. So what did we change? So the flagship practice was Trinity Medical Centre, and then we spread out in a flag court and then in five practices within South Tyneside. And both flag court and Trinity were really enthusiastic from the outset. So collaborating with the practice, we began to have a look at what their current pathways were for managing long-term conditions, and then sat and collaboratively looked at how we could integrate into that pathway. It became clear that some of the steps within that patient journey did result in missed opportunities, duplication and sometimes additional work. So then we redesigned the pathway and explored different opportunities to really increase the efficiency of those pathways. And this has resulted in a new pathway which also included additional training for healthcare assistants who can now perform spirometry, a full clinic dedicated to COPD or diabetes patients, and a kind of one-stop approach to long-term condition. And the initial contact clinics, the patients were invited by letter once they contacted to make and book that annual review appointment. We were made aware that they would see a nurse for the first 20 minutes of that appointment, and that after that they would be offered an appointment with a self-care coach, where we would give an overview of the service, do an initial PAM, and kind of identify any social needs. So the PAM level at that point determined the next course of action. So as I said at the beginning, those with a lower activation were then offered a follow-up appointment for a more higher level of intervention, where the higher levels of more activated patients may have just been given some brief information, advice, and connected in the community asset. So So the impact, as you can see, some stats. So 633 referrals over the first 2 years. Started in one practice, as I said, that was Trinity Medical Centre, branched out in the Flagport and now within the five practices. The average person improved, PAM score of 7 points, 11.2 for people who were less activated, which was the one PAM level 1 and 2. 309 introductions to assets and groups within the local borough, 24% reduction in appointments, 3% reduction in the number of rescue packs that were prescribed for COPD patients within the practice. And we conducted a GP survey where 80% of participants said that they felt they had enough support from local services to help manage the long-term health condition. And 73% were confident in managing their own health. So the impact, it's not just about the data, which obviously we can collect the data and evidence that we are having an impact on the system, we are having an impact on, you know, stories from the staff, from their time management and things like that. We have a huge impact on the people that we work with. It's frequent that patients will say, this is changing life, you know, where's this service been? Or can I recommend this to, you know, my next door neighbour who's at a different practice? Because they really do find it really beneficial. So one of the case studies being one of the workers was supporting a gentleman called Gary. So Gary had COPD, was exacerbated by the fact that he continued to smoke and during a time of severe mental illness. So he had attended psychosocial interventions previously with psychotherapy and things like that. However, he wasn't sleeping during the night, so that had a huge impact on his mental health as well. So we wanted to look at different ways that he could manage his anxiety and kind of take a little bit more control over his obsessive compulsive thoughts and feelings. So we were supported in using the five areas model to help him understand that cycle of thoughts and behaviours. We explored different mindful activities that he could then incorporate into his daily routine. Mindfulness is something he does. Yeah, I've had an update since this, and I've just yoga as well, so we started doing yoga as well. Which has obviously massively improved his sleep, his mental health, and kind of that snowball effect of just being able to explore some of those wider contributing factors to his management of his long-term condition, and really being able to sit and unpick that has made that huge snowball effect in the very different areas of his life. And he wasn't sleeping in the same bed as his wife, because obviously he was up during the night and that kind of thing. Now he is, so that's a huge impact to the relationship as well. Gary's initial PAM was 45.3, which is at level 1, and then it had risen to 58.1, which is at level 3. So just like little case studies, we could do a full presentation on the case studies to be fair. So what we know is that the relationships across the system are key, which obviously has been discussed earlier. So regardless of your employer, we're all working together to deliver world-class care that supports people to age well whilst giving them the most value for people out of every pound of taxpayers' money. And it's that kind of, we're all in the same boat, we're in the same boat together. So regardless of everybody, third sector, statutory sectors, things like that, we're all in it together, aren't we? Wanting the best for the people that we're working alongside. So it's through these relationships that we've been able to expand our learning to improve self-management through psychosocial interventions by integrating it with other pathways. So some projects that we're doing at the moment is a high-intensity user project working within A&E and alongside the psychiatric liaison team. A high-intensity user project working with MDT teams in primary care. Self-care coaches now integrating into secondary care pathways, collaborating with the IAP team. Using the admission to hospital as a teachable moment to kind of have, you know, that beginning, that initial intervention within that setting, and then follow that into the community. Continuing to roll out the self-care coaching offer to the five practices that we're in, and as most of you are aware from May this year, that will be a service that's rolled out to every GP practice within South Tyneside. We have link workers supporting integrated care teams to connect those to community assets, social activities, peer support, peer networks. All of which requires us to continuously connect and collaborate with our public sector and third sector colleagues. They're all facilitated by a SPOC, a single point of contact, which is a single telephone number manned by experienced practitioners, and a secure NHS email to reduce barriers to any other agencies who are sending us referrals. Our ambition is to continue to identify gaps and learn from the national evidence base and grow the knowledge, skills and confidence in the whole system to develop a resilient approach to supporting people to look after themselves and achieve maximum independence whilst living longer, healthier and more fulfilling lives. And this diagram further highlights the importance of having a range of competencies within the system, the need for different conversations based on the level of activation of the people that we're working with. Our psychosocial practitioners and self-care coaches have the necessary skills to improve confidence and importance in those who are less activated, whether this be through solution focus, CBT, interviewing techniques. And our link workers and volunteers connect those with optimum levels of motivation to assess like the neighbourhood, see what's going on in the area. If they're really highly activated, they're very likely to, you know, be approachable and being signposted. They also provide behaviour change training to a wide range of professionals and volunteers across the borough to support other practitioners having different types of conversations with people. And we're working across the South Tyneside system offering an equitable person proactive approach. So what did we learn? So we looked at what's worked well, what's not worked so well. And we found that integrated pathways, such as the link workers being part of the annual review appointments, has worked really well in terms of reach, so in terms of number of referrals. We're conscious that the people who are less activated are the people who are more likely not to attend those appointments. They tend not to engage that well in planned care. So we introduced proactive identification to target specific groups and people who are less activated. And we also introduce low threshold access through MDTs. Evidence in impact on the wider system has probably been the biggest challenge. It's been quite difficult and quite time consuming. One of the recommended questions is, and how have you overcome this? And in terms of the primary care data, the answer would be, with the support and willingness from our primary care colleagues, having those relationships and integrating into those pathways has been fantastic. In terms of the secondary care data, ask me again in 3 months. So as previously highlighted, the main factors that enable our project is the willingness of the system to be open to something different, to be open to learn and test different ways of working and different pathways, and really real emphasis on that collaborative approach. Of that we're there, you know, to assist each other and not let it create any more work for any medical practitioners. And the alliance and principles of honesty and trust were really shown by the GP staff, as particularly Trinity being the initial practice, approaching surgery with something brand new and saying, can we have a bash at this? So then being really brave enough to trust us to have a go and to facilitate us being able to do that has been fantastic. We explored the original pathway and the staff were empowered to be part of that, of looking at the pathways, reflecting on them, what are the barriers and how can we introduce a new integrated pathway. So in terms of the initiative link to the Alliance Principles and Better You approach, let me read that, and then the principles are demonstrated by our staff through consistency in our interactions that the place the person in the driving seat. As the patient is the person, they possess the answers, they're the expert in their own healthcare. So having those different types of conversations, we only have to listen and use techniques such as shared decision making to support them to overcome the feeling of being overwhelmed, to increase the skills to take control of their own health, and to introduce them activity and skills, and to believe in them, to have that different type of